Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and we will begin our exploration of the exocrine salivary glands, starting with the largest, which is the parotid gland. In this first session, we will focus only on where we can actually find the parotid gland, because it is unique in that it is not right next to or within the oral cavity like the other salivary glands. So we will spend the majority of the time discussing the boundaries of the parotid fossa. But let's get our very, very basic bearings first. So the parotid gland is located in the parotid fossa, which is in the parotid region, which basically just means this posterolateral portion of the face. So in the most general terms, it's going to be anterior to the ear, over the ramus of the mandible, but not quite into the cheek region here. So you can see that the teeth are right here. So that's the most general terms of where you can find that parotid gland, but let's get a bit more specific regarding the boundaries of the parotid fossa. So the anterior boundary will be both the ramus of the mandible, which is this vertical portion of the mandible here, and the masseter muscle, which is going to lie just superficial to the ramus of the mandible. And you can actually palpate your masseter. If you clench your teeth and feel over your mandible, you will be feeling that masseter muscle contracting. The posterior boundary is going to be formed by the mastoid process of the temporal bone and your sternocleidomastoid muscle, which, if you recall, is attached to the mastoid process. The superior boundaries include the temporomandibular joint, which I'm circling right here, as well as the external acoustic meatus, which is located right here. You can see actually on this image of the parotid gland on this donor that this parotid gland actually extends a little superior to that general area. And this is an important concept as there is always variation between individuals, and that these boundaries we're discussing right now are just representations of the most typical location of the parotid gland. Lastly, the inferior boundary is the hardest to conceptualize and see, and this is the angular tract. In fact, we can't see it on either one of these images. The angular tract is a dense fascial band that is located between the parotid and the submandibular glands, which the submandibular gland would be located in the submandibular triangle, which would be kind of deep to the platysma region right in there. So if you can think of a fascial band kind of between those two glands, that is where the angular tract would be located, but it's very often removed during dissection. So those are the boundaries of the parotid fossa. Let's do a quick review. So what do you think about this? Which muscle is an anterior boundary of the parotid fossa? Is it A, the cricothyroid, B, the masseter muscle? Sometimes you'll hear that referred to as the masseter muscle, but I'll always say masseter muscle. C, omohyoid muscle, D, sternocleidomastoid muscle, and E, trapezius. All right, so since we just discussed this, hopefully this is fresh in your mind, and you know that the correct answer is the masseter muscle, which, with the ramus of the mandible, which it sits superficial to, is going to form that anterior boundary of the parotid fossa. The cricothyroid muscle is quite a ways off, and it's off associated with the larynx. The omohyoid is off being a strap muscle, and while it's important in many anterior cervical triangle subdivisions, it does not play a role in the parotid fossa. The sternocleidomastoid muscle does play a role in terms of the parotid fossa, but it is a posterior boundary, not an anterior boundary. And lastly, the trapezius isn't correct. It is too posterior. Okay? So that was a nice and quick roundup of the parotid fossa. Thank you for your time and attention.